will join us again here on the 27th, and we're wrapping up this year.
Yeah,
and we're wrapping up our series that What Child Is This? And so
it's been fun.
It has.
I've enjoyed it.
Yeah.
In fact, even being in the pulpit together right now is kind of fun.
Amazing we fit. So anyway, but it is good to be here today, and it's good to be with Pastor Lois again. And anyway, we welcome you, St. Paul's.
Yeah. Welcome, Prairie Chapel United Methodist Church.
And Tonkawa First United Methodist Church.
And also the Northern Oklahoma College students. We welcome all of you. We are glad that you have joined us here online.
And all of our friends from all over.
Oh, yes,
and
family.
It's been amazing through this process of this year how many new friends we've made and how many people have tuned in and listened. So,
that's right. Welcome.
So anyway, welcome to worship.
Go tell it on the mountain, over the hills and everywhere. Go tell it on the mountain that Jesus Christ is born. While shepherds kept their watching over silent flocks by night, behold, throughout the heavens there shone a holy light. Go tell it on the mountain, over the hills and everywhere. Go tell it on the mountain that Jesus Christ is born. The shepherds feared and trembled when low above the earth rang out the angel chorus that hailed the Savior's birth. Go tell it on the mountain, over the hills and everywhere. Go tell it on the mountain that Jesus Christ is born. Down in a lowly manger, the humble Christ was born. And God sent us salvation that blessed Christmas morn. Go tell it on the mountain, over the hills and everywhere. Go tell it on the mountain that Jesus Christ is born. Go tell it on the mountain, over the hills and everywhere. Go tell it on the mountain that Jesus Christ is born. Go tell it on the mountain, over the hills and everywhere. Go tell it on the mountain that Jesus Christ is born.
Time in the service that we come to our offerings. An offering is a significant part of worship. We offer our gifts and our talents. We offer our time.
Mm-hmm.
We give back to God the blessings which God has given us.
Many
and oftentimes
blessings.
That means our offering and our tithes and offerings as well. And this has been a hard year on churches.
Mm-hmm.
And I want to begin by thanking you all for being so diligent at continuing your tithes
Thank
and
you.
Offerings
Thank
and
you.
Allowing us as a church, as particular churches, to continue to function both in service and online.
And creatively.
Awesome.
Yeah.
And Lois and I, we thank you for all of the Christmas gifts and greetings and cards that we've received.
And visits. Thank you.
And you all have blessed us so much, and we thank you. But in this time of offering, it's a time of giving back to mm-hmm. God for mm-hmm. the building of God's kingdom.
That's right.
Lois, would you like to pray and ask a blessing on the offering
today? Sure. Let's pray. Let's join our hearts. right now. Gracious Heavenly Father, we do lift up this time to you right now, Lord, a time that you have carved out, a time that you have set apart for us to give back, just even in a small portion of the many ways that you have blessed us. And so, Lord, right now we lift up our offerings, our gifts, our tithes to you, Lord, and pray that your hand may be upon them, Lord, that you may multiply them to be used for you and you alone to further your kingdom. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Take this time and to pray for all of our concerns on each of our hearts this day.
So if you have a candle, light your candle. One prayer that I have, that I think we all have, is that thanking God that thus far the Lord has been with us, and that's been good.
Amen.
Let's take a moment and pray for our world, our community. Pray for one another. Let's pray.
Just a child born in a manger outside of Bethlehem, born to Mary, son of the Father, a precious gift to man. He was just a small baby, though his life
all eternity. His beauty was yet to unfold to all of those who could see. Wise men brought three gifts to the new king, the best that they could bring. But their gifts weren't close to God's gift, the gift of a new king. He is Jesus. Salvation, you are the King of Kings. Perfect gift, the gift of the Father, the gift of love that you bring. He is Jesus, Emmanuel. God be here on earth as well. His presence salvation, you are the King of Kings.
I never was much of a talker. I came by it honest, neither was my daddy. Well, he got his mouth shut one time by a big old angel. I reckon that tend to make a fella careful. I got old enough, I left. I went out in the desert so I could think about it all. You know, the morning I left, my daddy, he walked me down to the river. He handed me this note. He said these were some of the words he said over me when I was a baby, when he got his voice back. He told me to chew on them. You, my boy, are going to go ahead of the Lord and get everybody ready for him. You're going to tell them that they can have their sins forgiven. Tell them that God's kindness is going to shine on them like the rising sun. I did it. I chewed on them, these words, for a long time. And then these words, they started chewing on me. I felt this his weight on me. So I went back to the river and I opened up my mouth and the words just started pouring out of them like a swarm of bees. I heard myself fussing at the religious people and telling everybody to get straight with God and get baptized. I tell you the truth, I wasn't even sure what I was saying, but I just kept talking and baptizing all the time with that weight on me. And then one morning, I look up, and there's this fella. He's walking toward me, and I heard myself saying, real quiet, almost under my breath, "There he is. That's the Lamb of God. He's going to take away all our sins." He walked right up to me. I saw then it was my cousin, it was Jesus. I hadn't seen him in years. He told me to baptize him. I did it. And we're standing next to each other in the river, and he's dripping wet. And I swear, I heard this voice like it's coming out the clouds saying, "That's my boy. And I am pleased with him." Isn't that something? I could not take my eyes off of him. He was shining. He's shining, I'll tell you, like the rising sun. And I felt that weight go off of me then, because I knew I had done my job. I had gone ahead of him. none of this was about me. Well, it never was. It was all about him. Well, still is.
Well, here we again are looking at what child is this, and who was this John? And, yeah, you know, Lois, I was thinking, you know, the manger scene that we use all the time, it doesn't have this guy named John in it, but there's this guy named John who's a huge part of the Christmas story.
Huge part, you're
yeah.
right.
Yeah, and he's best known because he baptized people, mm-hmm. and they call him John the Baptist, and
that's right.
And we don't know much about this, and you know, you remember we used to put John the Baptist, we hit him up in the loft in our manger scene at home, because we just felt like he should be there. You know, he was a part of the story, such a big part.
Yeah.
Why isn't he in the manger scene?
That's right.
You know, so we thought about that, and we added John. And but anyway, we learned a lot about John from the book of Matthew. And in the third chapter, it talks about how John mm-hmm. proclaimed the coming of Jesus and the Messiah
right.
in the wilderness.
And, that's right.
Yeah.
John the Baptist appeared in the wilderness of Judea.
Prepare the way of the Lord.
That's yeah. right. But and he was proclaiming another message as well, where he says, repent.
Yeah. Yeah. But, you know, we don't hear a whole lot about that, except later on we're going to learn a little bit more about his message of repentance and salvation mm-hmm. and all that in mm-hmm. Zechariah, you know, which is a scripture we're really going to be looking at today.
Right.
But in Matthew 3, we do learn some things about John. He
right.
was an odd duck. He was kind of a strange man, and a lot of the prophets were.
That's right. They were.
Yeah.
The messengers of God, usually who God chooses, or unexpected
yeah.
people.
I guess we're all kind of weirdos.
but
anyway, he wasn't like a normal priest of his day either.
That's
he didn't
right.
dress in fancy robes and silk
nope.
and wear a funny
nope.
hat. He did wear funny stuff, though.
Yeah. He wore camel's hair, and in honor of John the Baptist today, I decided to wear my camel's hair.
Oh, is that camel's hair? Okay, all right, camel's hair, yeah.
And
yeah.
a leather belt around his
sure.
waist.
I have a leather belt.
Yeah.
So anyway,
right.
yeah. But he ate weird stuff,
ate
too.
Weird stuff.
And I was thinking, you know, maybe we should try that for supper tonight. What do you think? A little locust and honey, you know?
And the wild honey doesn't sound too bad to me, but locusts?
Yeah, locusts, yeah,
I don't know.
You know. I don't know. Maybe it's just pods off of a locust tree, but who knows? But
who knows?
Locusts and honey, I think it's probably talking about the little bug. You know, you remember used to tie strings around their feet when in time to the neighbor's porch.
And let them fly around
yeah,
on a
yeah.
string.
Yeah, yeah.
I was a strange
yeah.
duck,
yeah,
too.
Yeah, you were a strange duck, too. But anyway, he stayed out in the desert. He wasn't around people like most preachers, but people would come out to him to see.
That's right. He was outside the boundaries. He was in the margins of the Rome area of Judea.
Yeah.
And in fact, he spoke against the leaders and the religious
Pharisees and the Sadducees.
The Pharisees,
even the
yeah.
religious leaders.
That's right.
And when they would come out, you remember what he called them?
A brood of vipers.
Yeah, a brood of vipers. Yeah, right. And he yeah. even called them the leaders of the temple at that time, or who would be
yeah.
the leaders of
to
the
repent.
Faith to repent. Yeah,
right.
What an
okay.
interesting thing.
But he also not only called those to repentance, but he also came to baptize those who came to him in the waters yeah. of the Jordan.
He baptized them in the waters of the Jordan,
yeah.
and he baptized them in the word that was coming, the word of salvation
yes,
in Jesus
right.
Christ, so
that's
they would
right.
hear this word.
Yeah.
They'd be drenched with this good news.
Right.
Repent, turn, prepare for the coming of the Messiah,
okay.
and be baptized, yeah. washed clean.
That's right.
And
and I loved how he, in his words, where John the Baptist took the attention off of himself, and to place it on Christ, where he says, I baptize you with water for repentance, but the one who is coming, the one, is more powerful than I. He's coming after me, and I'm not even worthy to carry his sandals. So he says, I baptize you, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire.
Yeah. And so when we look at John, before we look at this passage, the one thing that we know for sure is that he was a different kind of fella, and he was a preacher, but he was a rebel in a sense, but a passive rebel.
Yes. He was known as a prophet. And so he has that name, but unlike the wise men in the Christmas story, he had no star to guide him.
Yeah.
And
unlike the angel, or I mean, unlike the shepherds, he didn't get to hear directly from an angel or hear the angels singing
to
from the sky.
And unlike Joseph, John didn't have a dream or dreams where the angels spoke to him on what to do.
Not a dream of his own.
And all he had, though, was the word of his father, Zechariah.
And what he would learn about the prophecies as he grew up.
That's right. And how he fit into the story of Jesus. Yeah. He understood that part. Maybe not completely, but he knew that he had
He kind of learned that from his father, Zechariah. And that's our scripture passage today. Let's take a moment and listen to Luke 1. 76 through 79, or actually, I think we go through to 80. But anyway, let's listen to this.
Then his father Zechariah was filled with the Holy Spirit and spoke this prophecy. Blessed be the Lord God of Israel. For he has looked favorably on his people and redeemed them. He has raised up a mighty Savior for us. In the house of his servant David, as he spoke through the mouth of his holy prophets from of old, that we would be saved from our enemies and from the hand of all who hate us. Thus he has shown the mercy promised to our ancestors, and has remembered his holy covenant, the oath that he swore to our ancestor Abraham, to grant us that we, being rescued from the hands of our enemies, might serve him without fear, in holiness and righteousness before him all our days. And you, child, will be called the prophet of the Most High, for you will go before the Lord to prepare his ways, to give knowledge of salvation to his people by the forgiveness of their sins. By the tender mercy of our God, the dawn from on high will break upon us, to give light to those who sit in darkness and in the shadow of death, to guide our feet into the way of peace. The child grew and became strong in spirit, and he was in the wilderness until the day he appeared publicly to Israel. This is the word of God for us today.
As followers of Christ, of Jesus, we too, like John, we're to walk in the light of God's peace, right?
Yeah. And here again, we find a passive message where, you know, you'd almost think that this king that's coming to transform the world, it might come in a different way. I mean, the people were looking for a more rebellious or more violent. But here he's calling the people to repentance rather than to take up arms or tear down the city and everything.
And that was passive then.
Yeah, and he was calling people to repent, and he was proclaiming the salvation that would come through Jesus from this darkness to sin.
That's right. And this way to walk in that peace of Christ ushering in the kingdom of God, and then that peace that comes with following him. And it seems like too many of us are more in this battle against the things that
we don't like.
And
instead of battling against the things we don't like, maybe we should be doing something different and telling the good news of the coming of Christ,
right,
just as John the Baptist did, and calling the world to repentance.
That's
and
right. You know, the good news of joy for all people, right? But
yeah.
Sometimes we go against that, don't we?
Yeah, you know, we live in a time that's very stressful. Time that's full of fear. And it's been really sad to see the message that's come out of a lot of Christians today that's been brought about by fears and by anxieties and mm-hmm. and always pointing fingers or, mm-hmm. or instead of calling people to repentance, trying to demonstrate how bad people are, and and in doing so, right. demonstrating how horribly most and or many people who are Christians need this same repentance yeah. too.
I think we lose our focus. You know, our focus is on others and those out there. Yeah. Instead of the focus on what we need to confess, what we need to repent.
And, you know, I think it's there's a part of this story that kind of helps us to maybe wrap our heads around this. And I don't know where, you know, what others think about this. There's not much written about what this honey and locust and honey stuff means. But John, he lived a very simple life, and he mm-hmm. ate what God provided.
Yes.
And here we see honey and locusts. And in thinking about that, maybe they represent what is easy to swallow and what's difficult to swallow in this message. You know, I think about locusts. I think locusts would be a little tough to swallow, you know.
Yeah.
And maybe that's like repentance, even though repentance is good. I mean, turning away from this life that doesn't work and turning toward a life in which we can have the abundance of God's love within our life is a good thing.
Yeah.
But oftentimes it's kind of like a pill we don't want to swallow, you know?
That's right.
We want to be in control of our lives.
Yeah.
We want to be the one who make our decisions,
right.
not follow in the way of somebody else, and not even if that somebody else is God.
That's right. And yet think about the sweetness of honey, which could represent our salvation.
Yeah.
And doesn't that sound good?
Yeah, it sounds good, doesn't it?
It does.
I mean, everybody's looking to be saved. I mean, we've looked so many ways within this world for a Savior.
Mm.
And we've missed sometimes that message that John had for us.
Mm-hmm.
And Advent is a focus on the coming of the Messiah. And oftentimes we look at this fulfillment of prophecy from old and how it came at the birth of Christ. But Advent also represents this coming of Christ again.
Mm-hmm.
And today, as we look at this Christmas event and the prophecies and the promises, I think, too, we can look at Advent and Christmas and see the promise that Jesus gave us of his coming again. And,
that's right. Yeah.
And in this, you know, here it is.
Yeah.
Do you hear the message that John has and he's giving about the coming of Jesus and how that message of that day for the people of God that day is the same message that God has for us today?
Yeah. To prepare ye the way, prepare your hearts, prepare your life for the coming of the kingdom of God, which is near, which is, I think, the Christmas story, the Christmas message of the kingdom is near through Christ.
Yeah.
And
Jesus left us with this call to mm-hmm. proclaim the good news of Jesus and go out and baptize. Proclaim the light of Jesus that shines in this darkness that we live in. And so there's not a whole lot different that John the Baptist was mm-hmm. given as something, as a call that's much different than us as Christians should have today.
Mm-hmm.
So the question that I have for us today, Lois, is are we walking in the path of peace and sharing the good news of God's salvation that comes through Jesus Christ?
Are we doing that? Are we living out that faith? Are we walking in that path of light and peace and hope and joy? That's our prayer. That's my prayer as we move out of this difficult year, this year 2020. And as we approach 2021, we still have the call to share the good news of great joy for all people, as John did.
You know, when I think about this Advent and Christmas story, and I think about where John the Baptist plays into this, yeah, I'm sure for the shepherds, the angels were really loud. But John, you know, Zechariah kind of teaches us that John, his son, would have a big mouth, and he would, you know, he would speak so loudly that people would come from all over Jordan and come from the area of Jerusalem and come out into the wilderness just to hear what he had to say and this call to repentance and this call of salvation.
Probably longed for
and
it.
And so he was probably the loudest person in this Christmas story. And when I think about that, that's the call that we're called to as well.
Yeah.
We're called to be loud voices for Christ.
That's right.
Not ones that are tearing people down. Yeah, we call people to repentance, to turn from the life that's not working for them, this life that's full of darkness, and to turn toward this light of peace that Christ has for us that shines in this darkness that guides us into this understanding of what it means to live in Christ.
That's right.
And this life that Christ always intended for us.
So we're called to walk in the peace that frees us from our own wilderness, our own darkness, and the darkness in the world.
So ending up and wrapping up this series on what child is this, I think Zechariah and John the Baptist teach us something about this. He is the one who we are called to repent to, the one who guides us into salvation. He is our salvation.
He is our salvation.
And he leads us to walk in the way of peace. And so in this series that we've done through Advent and Christmas, it ends today, Lois. I have to say, I've done a lot of reflecting, and I've learned and I've grown in this, and I sure hope others have as well.
Me too. Yeah.
Anyway,
we'll close.
Our closing benediction.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious, gracious, gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace.
You know, in a couple of days it's going to be a new year.
I hope it's
a
good year.
And I know a lot of people are sure glad to hear that 2020 is on its way out. And I don't think people want to have 2020 vision too much anymore. They want to move into 2021. And so, anyway, I pray that God bless you all as we begin the walk toward this new year. God bless.